face of a hurricane, they would meet with a smile. Because without a smile, even then the hurricane may come. So why not meet it with a smile? That's their philosophy. It's a multiple kind of philosophy. And according to Jack Davis, historically aborigines learn to keep themselves alive. Look at the statement, how will aborigines keep themselves alive? By laughing. Because they have been through so many years of, thousands of years of atrocities committed against them. So they survive, they have to survive. So how do they survive? By laughing. By laughing at themselves, not at the right people. By laughing at themselves. That's their survival. So it's a very important comment. An aboriginal humor derives from, not from white creation or anything like that, it is drawn from particular skills of aboriginal themselves. So they don't harm anyone. They laugh at themselves, that's all. Then, communal and cathartic. It's another very important point. Just as I have mentioned in the context of aboriginal autobiographies, there's a communal element in Jack Davis's theatre. He does not tell stories about individuals. It is always about his community, communal community. So they are both communal and cathartic. And his smile is coming for a better future. Then this point that I have already mentioned. Synchronic theatre. That's a comment made by Christopher Green. He has introduced the concept of synchronic theatre. I think this element we find in almost all plays of Jack Davis. No Suja, the Green or Suja. The interplay between Western dramatic tradition and indigenous times. Because Austrian literature belongs to post-colonial literatures. Nowadays we have a paper of Institute of English titled Contemporary Literatures in English. So there we have Canadian, Sri Lankan, Pakistani, Filipino literature, Australian, West African, Canadian, all things are introduced in that paper. Contemporary Literatures in English. And there's another term for that, New Literatures in English. And there's an older term for that, post-colonial places. So, all are the same thing, old mind, new bodies. That's all. The next day, when we reframe this discourse, I come up with another term. I'm looking for that, something difficult and something very hard to understand. So, there we have again, we have post-colonial places. Then the polysemic nature. What do you mean by polysemic? There is no one meaning. Polysemic nature of it. Polysemic, if you look at the meaning, if you Google the meaning, it means multiplicity of meanings. There is no single meaning. There is a multiplicity of meanings conveyed by each play. Major words. And balloon, ironically enough, it was performed, ironically set, it was ironically set to the bicentenary year of 1988. Because British colonizers first colonized Australia in 1788. So while the white Australians were celebrating the colonization, the 200th year of solar colonization, Jack Davis set the play, ironically set the play in the bicentenary year. So it's a mockery of European colonization. Australian novel has much to do with the contemporary Australia. The situation in contemporary Australia. Australia, which was sunset terra nullius centuries back, is now witnessing escalating population. So my uncle, his next generation, and his their generation, they are all living in Darwin. They haven't come back to India, never. So they will continue to live in Australia. So imagine hundreds of thousands of migrants living in Australia. So Australia is now witnessing escalating population. to such an extent that minorities have their own radio in Melbourne and Sydney. They have their own radio. And they keep updated. Nobody else is called up for seminars on multiple spaces or things like that. But they are very watchful. They know what is happening at the University of Kerala or the University of Kerala. And they keep broadcasting all those things to the minority audience. So they are very happy about that. They are happy that things are coming up about Australia. So escaping population. Australia is of the boom population boom. Widening economic success with the technological development, with multinational companies establishing their offices in Melbourne, Sydney, even in Victoria, there are multinational companies. So widening economic success, marked cultural diversity. All these things have established that Australian society is not homogeneous. Gone are the days when you talk about Australianness or nationality, nationalism. But now Australia is made up of many groups with competing interests and political claims. And I think it would be appropriate if we recalled what Brian Castle had to say. What did he say? Australians have to begin to lose themselves, not in nationality, but in assimilating other cultures, other voices, etc. So that is quite true. So a protocol was provided for novices because of both cultural and material factors. So when you do cultural studies, when you do some literary studies, you can't keep away economic factors and material factors. They form part of the baggage. You can't say, it's just like when girls get married to other families, you can't afford to say that I will just have the husband, the young man as the husband. Not the mother-in-law, not the father-in-law, not the daughter-in-law, not the sister-in-law. Can you say that? Do you have an option? Hindu wives, Christian wives, do you have an option? The family into which you are married in, it comes as a baggage. It's a package. It's a package. It comes as a package. I always tell my students, you won't get married. You get married to family. You don't get married to a young man, well-placed young man. You get married to a whole family. You can't evoke your mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, and things like that. That's not possible. And that's a parting advice I give my MBA and MPhil students. You don't have thoughts of having just a man, young man in your custody. You get married to family. So you want to get married to the family, not to a single person. If you get married to a single person, you immediately get ended up in a divorce. That's for sure. So adjust yourself. Flexibility is the key term. It is applicable for the boys as well. Don't remain complacent. It's applicable for you as well. You also get married to your family. But in Indian bride's case, it's all the more truthful. That's right. So, what was I saying? When you consider cultural studies, material factors come along with that. So, the material changes in Australia get reflected in the fiction that they have been producing. So, here we have the sacred river. Which is a part of the trilogy of early Australia. We have the sea permit. Previous issues there. Or it's the lieutenant, Sarah Thomas. Before we go to the themes, I think Kate Grendel, she has made a very wise observation. Places are not very important. Places, PLACES, are not very important. Put a few dots. But the idea of a place is very important to me. Places are not very important, but the idea of a place is very important to me. And this novel, The Secret River, it actually shows the origin of this novel was her desire to understand the history of her ancestor, Solomon Wiseman. Solomon wise man. And her inspiration to know more about her ancestor. Resulted in a deep set research into Aboriginal history, especially near the Hawkesbury River, near Sydney. So that's how she embarked on that long journey. So at first she had planned to write a non-fictional account of her journey, of her search. But finally she decided to write a full-fledged novel, and we have this novel, a very popular novel. And it is said that she took 5 years, the novel took 5 years and 20 drafts to complete. So it is another a grand level of revision, 20 drafts to get published. And the novel is dedicated to the novel is dedicated to the Aboriginal people of Australia. So that's why I find that there are very few White Australian works in the syllabus. The emphasis is all on Aboriginal Australia. And this lady, she had to deal with, she was actually presenting what happened almost 100 years back. And many people criticized her, many historians, especially the famous Australian historian John Hurst. He criticized her for misinterpreting historical facts. That was the greatest criticism that she had to face. But she never gave a penny for such criticisms. And she says, they recognize that the story is my act of acknowledgement, my way of story, saying, this is how I am sorry. So, one, the book gets published, many reprints have come around, and this is the way I say, I would say sorry. That means, I am not prepared to say sorry. I have presented a fictional representation of what has happened 200 years back. So that is her stand. So we have another strong Australian woman. So I think we take a look at these, and this is the last slide, 111th slide. Oh, 112. So these are the various themes. Clash of civilizations. It actually gives us in a nutshell the various aspects of white Australian encountering Australia. First of all, clash of civilizations. And it was Captain Cook who set his foot on Australia in January 1788. Captain Cook. And even now he is considered as a great national legend in Australia. The first European to set foot on Australia. And throughout the novel, Grenville, she juxtaposes British and Aboriginal understandings of various important social concepts. What are the various important social concepts? About clothing, food habits, marriage, rearing of children. So the Aboriginals and the Europeans have totally different views of looking at these things. About marriage, about personal property, about family relationships, about hunting and farming, about land, about the natural environment. So they are opposite poles. So naturally, such an encounter would result in utter clash of civilizations. So that's the first thing. Then who won the battle? Who won the battle between two civilizations? Ultimately, the British settlers won the battle with the help of course, gunfire and theft and alcohol. They were the people who introduced alcoholism among the Aboriginals. Same thing has happened in Kerala. New colonialism. Because among the tribal people in Kerala, especially in the Attapadi region, for the past several months, there have been many suicides, especially by male members. And many socialists have taken studies about this. And some of them have come to the conclusion that the newly introduced alcoholism and the variation in standards of living between the mainstream people and the Adivasi people along with other sociological issues, have led to this sudden rise in suicide. These things have been there before, but in the new changes, new variations of sociological status, there is a sudden escalation in the suicide rate. It's an alarming thing. Then next point, aboriginal culture. So that's a major theme. Of course, he has dedicated the book to aborigines. So naturally, aboriginal people of Australia. So naturally, that's a major theme. She has presented Australian aboriginal culture as a lost game. Sadly, the aboriginals have lost the battle. They have given up. After a long battle, they have given up. So she says Australian aboriginal culture is a lost game. And in her presentation of aboriginals and Europeans, we have to say that she has given equal importance to aboriginal people and the Europeans. By way of characterization, we find almost equal number of aboriginals and European people in the novel. And she has also contrasted the over-consumption of Western civilization with the aboriginals' understanding of maintaining delicate balance of nature. Aboriginals know how to handle nature. They know that nature is very delicate. And when we continue to live in the lap of motherland, we have to be very careful. We have to be very careful in our dealings with Mother Earth. But the Western civilized people, they never gave a penny to take care of the Mother Earth. It was all exploitation and nothing else. So that's also important. Then, alternative path to Australian development. Actually, there are two characters, Smash and Sullivan. There are two characters, Smasher Sullivan and Thomas Blackwood. And Grenville has set up two alternative paths of Australian development through these two characters, Smasher Sullivan and Thomas Blackwood. Smasher Sullivan here represents the path of racial and physical domination of the aborigines. Whereas Blackwood, he represents the choice of peaceful coexistence. That was originally available to the British colonizers, but they did not mind, they did not give much value to that wise choice. They could have made a peaceful existence, such a deal could have been struck with the aborigines. But they believed in exploiting, destroying aboriginal identity. So these are two options that she offers. Then social hierarchy, that's another very important point. Throughout the novel, the theme of social hierarchy is there. And she has highlighted the importance of social hierarchy on personal development. Okay, for example, in the chief character, the main character is Williams. How his psyche, the impact of his psyche by the social hierarchy that was existent during that period. So that is important. Then the humiliation, before migrating to Australia, the humiliation he had to suffer at the hands of several people in London. So that makes him decide to migrate to Australia. Any place other than England. So then he releases this show. Then self-creation. The story of modern Australia is a map of self-creation. Just as we talk about modern America, it's purely a map of self-creation. The convicts, who were the first occupants of, first settlers of Australia? The convicts. So they had a bad history. God had not given them a chance. But Australia gave them a chance to start new lives. So you have convict fiction. There are representative convict fiction. Fiction says stories written by convicts who were settled in Australia. So the story, the secret tells the story of William Thorpe. One of the first settlers who arrived in New South Wales as a convict. So Dilip Kovic was a convict and he arrived, it was as a convict that he arrived in New South Wales. In Australia they refer to it as NSW, New South Wales. Especially we refer to Tamil Nadu as TN and Kerala as KN. Andhra Pradesh is AP. There is no other place. So he came as a convict and as an outcast. And how he carved out a place for himself among the Australia's ruling class. So Australia is a place which does not destroy people. It's a place where you can start your new life's world. So the real example is that we need convict. Then the British class system. So the Stephen River also criticizes the British, the rigid British class system which existed during the latter, the 18th century and the 19th centuries, which wouldn't give common people like William a chance to live. So that is also criticized. Then the disorientation of the immigrants. So that's always there. It's not a just a theme. So it has always been there. Through the character of Sam, Grenville explores the disorienting experience of the immigrant. She works hard, she hardly complains, but she has a difficult time settling their new life in Australia. So the hardships that she had to undergo, the way she had to bring her child up, so those were difficult situations. So those are the main points. I hope that I have done justice to the task given to me as well as the time allowed to me. I always believe in speaking less. I have never spoken so much on one day. I always remember this day as one of the memorable.